Hello, my dear children. Once again, welcome to our physics class. Hope you all are fine over there. We were discussing about capacitor and capacitance. In the previous session, we had derived an expression for capacitance of a parallel plate capacitor with dielectric, also without dielectric. Today, let's talk about the energy stored in a capacitor, energy density of a capacitor. Also, let's discuss about the different combinations of capacitors. So, listen carefully, my dear children. Let's get started with today's session. So, children, let's discuss about the energy stored in a capacitor. How much energy can be stored in a capacitor? Or how can we store energy in a capacitor? Let's discuss the process behind that. So for that, consider a parallel plate capacitor as shown in the figure. Here, the first plate of the parallel plate capacitor is usually charged and the second plate is earthed. So we usually give positive charges to the first plate of the parallel plate capacitor. Here, we bring the first positive charge to the first plate. Here we can easily bring this positive charge because no other charges are present here to offer any repulsion or attraction. So we can easily bring this positive charge. Not much effort is required, not much force is to be applied to bring this first positive charge to the plate. And we are continuing with charging the capacitor, so more and more charges get accumulated on the first plate of this parallel plate capacitor. So suppose the second positive charge is coming close to the capacitor. So what happens? The second charge will experience a repulsive force from the first positive charge. So if we want to bring the second positive charge to the capacitor plate, we need to do some work or we need to apply a force against that repulsive force. Okay, so the work done is more. Again, another positive charge gets accumulated on the capacitor. So to bring this third positive charge to the capacitor plate, we need to do more and more work than in the previous case because two positive charges are there to offer repulsion. Okay, again, if we want to bring fourth positive charge to the capacitor, we need to do more work because it suffers repulsion from these three positive charges. So, to bring more and more positive charges, we need to apply more and more force. That is, work done also increases. This work done is stored in the form of energy, and the energy lies in the dielectric medium of the capacitor. Okay, now suppose charge stored in the capacitor is Q, and we had already discussed in our previous session, whenever a charge Q is given to a capacitor, its potential increases. So let the rise in potential as a result of charge Q is capital V. Then how can we find out the work done? How much work is done to charge this capacitor? We had already studied an equation relating the charge Q, potential V and work done in our class 10 physics. Do you remember the equation? That is, potential difference V is equal to work done W by Q. I hope you remember this equation. From this expression, we can easily find out a formula for work done. So what is work done? Work done W is equal to Q into V. Okay, so this is the expression for work done in charging the capacitor. Now, suppose we have given a very small charge Q to the capacitor. So if the charge given is very, very small, the rise in potential as a result of that charge also will be very, very small. The work done also will be very, very small. So let the work done, let that small work done be denoted by dW equal to small charge Q, and as a result of that small charge Q, let the rise in potential be very small, and that small rise in potential is denoted by dV. Okay, so this is the expression for small work done to increase the potential to a very small amount, that is dV. Then what will be the total work done to increase the potential from 0 to maximum value V? So the total work done is obtained by integrating this expression. Okay, that is our usual method. So the total work done is obtained by integrating dW between the limit 0 to V, because the potential is increasing from 0 to maximum value V, equal to integral 0 to V. What is dW? dW is Q into dV. Okay, so let's continue the same derivation in our next slide. So work done, the total work done W equal to integral 0 to V Q dV. Capacitor, we know that capacitance E is equal to Q by V. So Q is equal to CV. Okay, so here instead of Q, substitute CV. Integral 0 to V CV dV equal to capacitance of a given parallel plate capacitor will be constant. So capacitance C is a constant. It can be taken outside the integral. Equal to C into integral 0 to V, V dV. And we had studied integral of x dx equal to x square by 2. Right? So similarly, integral V dV equal to V square by 2. So equal to C into V square by 2. And after integration, put the limits. What is the limit? 0 to V equal to C by 2. Take this to outside the bracket into, instead of V, substitute the upper limit, which is the upper limit V itself. So V square minus, instead of V, again substitute the lower limit. Lower limit is 0. So you will get half C V square. The C by 2 can be written as half C. Half C, in the within the bracket you have V square. So half C V square. This is the expression for work done to charge a capacitor. And this work done itself is stored in the form of energy, potential energy actually, between the plates of the capacitor. So this is the expression for energy stored in a capacitor, half CV square. Again, two other forms are also there which can be easily derived from this expression. See, potential energy or energy stored in the capacitor U is equal to half CV square, which can be written like half CV into V. Right? So half CV into V is half CV square itself, equal to half into, what is CV? CV is Q. Then what is left? V. So this is another expression for energy. What is that? Half QV. Okay. Then again, another expression is, what is V? See, half QV equal to half into Q into, what is V? From this expression, we can easily derive V. What is V? V is equal to Q by C. So, instead of V, we can write Q by C. So, you will get the energy expression as Q into Q, Q square by 2C. Okay. So, this is another expression for energy stored in a capacitor. So, we have three different expressions for energy stored in a capacitor. which are the three different expressions: half CV square, half QV, Q square by 2C. And here, among these three expressions, half CV square is the most accepted formula to find energy, because here we have Q. In both the expressions we have Q, and Q is not a measurable quantity. But at the same time, V is a measurable quantity, C is also a measurable quantity. So both the measurable quantities appear in this particular equation, half CV square. So this is the widely accepted formula to find energy. Okay, so we got three different expressions for energy. Next, let's find out the expression for energy density in a capacitor. Energy density in capacitor is denoted by small u. And the definition for energy density is that it is the energy stored per unit volume. So energy density small u is energy. Energy is represented by or denoted by u. Energy stored per unit volume. Okay. So we already got an expression for energy. What is that? Half CV square divided by volume. So we need to rewrite, or we need to modify this half CV square. So first let's modify that. Half CV square can be written as half into C is the capacitance. And what is the expression for capacitance of a parallel plate capacitor? Yeah, we had discussed in the previous session. It is epsilon naught into A by D. Okay, so we had substituted an expression for C. Next is V square. So in the previous session, we had discussed an expression for potential V in terms of electric field and distance. What is that? E into D. Potential V is equal to electric field E into D. Here D is the distance between the plates. So V is ED. So V square will be ED whole square. Okay. Now, here we have half into epsilon naught into A by D. Then we have ED whole square. ED whole square is E square into D square. So here we have D, here we have D square, here D and 1 D from the D square will cancel. So what is left? We have half epsilon naught A E square D. Okay, E square into D. So we have modified our half CV square as half epsilon naught A into E square D. Then what is energy density? Energy density is U by volume. That means half CV square by volume. What is the expression for half CV square now? It is half epsilon naught A E square D. Right? All divided by volume. And what is the expression for volume? Volume expression is area into distance, where A, area is the area of the plates, and D is the distance between the two parallel plates. See, if you consider two parallel plates like this, area will be, or A will be the area of these plates, and D will be the distance between these two plates. Okay, now here we have D, here we have D, it will cancel, A cancel. And what is left? Half epsilon naught E square. So this is the expression for energy density small u. Half epsilon naught E square. Okay, so the energy density depends upon the electric field. Now, if you connect the plates of a capacitor, parallel plate capacitor, together by a copper wire, what happens? What do you think? See, in a parallel plate capacitor, one plate will be positively charged, another plate will be negatively charged. So if you connect these two plates together, sparking will occur because positive and negative plates are connected together by means of a copper wire. So it must not happen. Okay.